So let's talk about biodiversity here. So we have been covering all kinds of stuff on microbes and microscopes. So we talked about viruses and bacteria and protists and fungi. We discussed all those groups of microbes, all the diversity of life that you can't see, and we did a lab about it. Now we're going to cover the diversity of life that we're kind of used to seeing in the world, which are plants and animals. And as a reminder, plants, in terms of food webs, ecology, pretty much all of them are producers, which means they produce their own food out of sunlight, so they're all doing photosynthesis. Our most basic form of plant in the world, and our kind of most primitive form of plant, if you want to think of it that way, are algaes and seaweeds. These were the first to appear on Earth. Our next big topic is going to be evolution, but algaes and seaweeds can only live in the water, and that's because they lack what we call vascular tissue. And vascular tissue is how plants transport water. So if you're looking at a plant, whether it's a tree or even a shrub or a tinier plant, they have stems to them. And these stems are designed to basically funnel water up the tree or plant and funnel sugars down the tree or plant through these kind of tubes that are in the stem. And those tubes, maybe you remember them from biology, they're called xylem and phloem. Xylem moves water, phloem moves sugar and other nutrients for the plant. Algae don't have that. So algae, it might kind of look like they have stems here, but the stems are not the same as a tree or a other kind of plant. There is no flow of water through algae because they live in the water. That is why they have to live in the water. Because they do not have like a root system where they can pump water to their leaves. So the entire plant pretty much has to be submerged in water all the time. And seaweeds are multicellular. You can see this is kelp. If you've ever eaten like sushi and you see that green stuff that's kind of wrapping around the rice and fish, that's seaweed. Seaweed is a plant. It's pretty big, so it has many, many cells, so it's definitely multicellular. But some algaes can also be single-celled. And most single-celled algae are still considered to be plants, even though they can be microscopic in size, like our ones on the top right, with the exception of something called blue-green algae, which is actually a cyanobacteria. It's actually a bacteria. But all the other kind of scummy stuff that you see in the pond or in the pool or whatever, if you don't clean it, that is technically a plant and it's technically microscopic. It's a microscopic plant. All right, so that covers algaes and seaweeds. And we're gonna kind of transition into more and more complex plants, more or less in the order that they appeared on Earth. So our next very, very simple plant is called a bryophyte or a moss. These do, they can live outside of the water, so they do have a very primitive kind of root structure to them, but they have no vascular structures as well. So they're kind of like land algae in a sense. So because they have no vascular structures, that means that they can't pump water from deep underground to their leaves way up high, so that for this reason, they all kind of cling to the ground, kind of like carpet. That is a moss or a bryophyte. And if you think of places that typically have mosses, occasionally you can see some around Houston. They're usually very shaded regions where there's not much sunlight. And for that reason, kind of water can kind of accumulate and pool in these regions. And the soil stays pretty, you know, moist year round. And that's kind of a good environment for a moss because mosses can't go all that long without water, essentially, is what it comes down to. All right. We jump to conifers next. There is another type of plant that's kind of in between mosses and conifers called ferns. And I didn't include them just because I didn't want this to get too long and weighted down. Ferns have vascular tissues, but they have very different seed formation compared to conifers and what our next trees are going to be. So conifers do not have flowers. You can think of these as things with like pine cones and typically have needle-like leaves. Anyway, the main distinguishing feature there between, they do have vascular tissue. Let me add that to this slide. That means that they actually have stems and they can grow very tall and they can pump water. They have root structures, all that stuff. So that is kind of a big jump. And then our last type of plant variety is angiosperms, which are basically flowering plants. This is the vast majority of plants on Earth have flowers. Even something like a grass, if you look at it at certain times of the year, you'll see seeds. But before you actually saw seeds on that grass, there were tiny little grass flowers. So all grasses actually possess flowers. You just don't really notice them. Most trees possess some kind of flowering structure. A lot of them, you don't really notice it either. Some of them, like the magnolia tree around Houston, you see these giant white flowers growing on them. And there are a lot of trees that kind of bloom, but many trees like oaks or, you know, elms, and you guys studied a lot of those different types of trees as you did your dichotomy ski, you know, they don't have crazy bright flowers, but they will have tiny, tiny little flowers at various times of the year. And those are called angiosperms. And these also have, obviously, if they're trees and grasses, they have vascular structured tissue as well. So they can pump water from the ground, so they have roots and all that stuff as well. But the distinguishing feature here is flowers. And this kind of revolutionized how plants kind of reproduce. A big challenge for a plant is that basically plants, like all other life forms, sexual reproduction is very important to them. So having kind of a mixture of genes and for the next generation is pretty important. They don't want to just make clones of themselves for the most part. So how do you sexually reproduce if you can't move? Essentially, is a pretty big challenge for a plant. And things like pine trees will generally rely on the wind to kind of blow pollen around. And that still happens for some angiosperms, but the vast majority of angiosperms, the reason they form flowers is so they can attract insects like bees and other beetles and things like that, that can visit the flower and then go fly off to another tree and carry some of the pollen on its legs and then basically impregnate another tree with that pollen that it's carrying. And so that's the reason that flowers exist. All right, so that mostly covers plants and some of the varieties of plants that we find in the world. Needless to say that plants form the bottom of the food chain in almost all ecosystems and are unbelievably important for life on Earth. So let's move on to animals next. All right, so when we are talking about the animal kingdom, we would say, I generally define animals as you kind of have two distinct groups. You have invertebrates and vertebrates. And when you get to college, if you study biology, usually you will take separate classes for this. So you'll take an invertebrate class and a vertebrate class as you learn all these different types of animals. And there are just unbelievable numbers in the world of each group. So I want to quickly run through a lot of the main types of invertebrates, things that don't have a backbone or don't have an internal skeletal structure, and things that are vertebrates, which have backbones. So let's start with our invertebrates. Our simplest invertebrate, and kind of in the same format as we went with plants, I'll kind of go from like simpler to more complex here. We have sponges. Normal sponges, which we can see on the right here, are just kind of this yellowish tissue. They actually don't have little SpongeBob eyes and smiley mouths, but sponges are real animals. And they are super simple. They just sit on the bottom of the ocean. And if you didn't know any better, you might think it's like a coral or a, you know, plant or something like that. But when scientists study them, they see animal-like cells, and they are actually consumers. So they are filter feeding through the water. So little tiny bits of dead stuff in the water, whatever's floating around, little nutrients, they basically kind of suck all that up and consume it. So they are not producers. They can't move, and they don't even have differentiated tissues. And what differentiated tissues mean are things like you have skin and muscle and intestines and stomach and nervous system and brain. You have all these different types of cells in your body, and those make up different kinds of tissues and organs. And so that means that you are differentiated. If we look at a sponge, there is no brain, there is no muscle, there is no anything. It's all the same kind of cell. So they are super, super duper simple, but they're still animals. Kind of the most basic form of animal. All right, kind of moving up in complexity. Cnidaria is basically jellyfish, and sea anemones, coral, and hydra. So most of these are what we would call sessile. They are basically bottom dwellers. So sea anemones, coral, and hydra are basically things that just kind of stick to the bottom of the ocean, but they can move. So they often have little tentacles that can kind of move around in the water or even grab things like a sea anemone. And coral are a bit of an exception there. Coral are kind of these weird organisms that live with algae, and it's actually a symbiotic relationship between a algae and a jellyfish-like creature is what a coral is. And then jellyfish actually can swim around. And so these are considerably more complex than sponges. They have differentiated tissues, so they have different kinds of digestive tissue and kind of primitive muscle tissues and things like that. And they even have a nervous system, so they can actually move and respond to things. Your nervous system is basically what gives you the sensation of touching and all your different senses, as well as allows you to move. But they don't have brains. So a jellyfish, even though it's swimming around, it doesn't really have a central brain. It's kind of all on reflex. And if you touch a jellyfish, it kind of like, you know, seizes up. You can kind of see those reflexes. So there's not too much going on there. All right, moving on up to some other organisms here. And moving up in complexity again, we have our mollusks. That's a phylum. By the way, these words like kingdoms and phylums, they're just different levels of what we would call classification. Taxonomy and classification. It's more important in things like biology, so I won't dwell too much on it here. So don't get thrown off. It's just like a big group. Phylum are a bigger group than classes, which is a bigger group than order, which is a bigger group than family, which is a bigger group than genus, which is a bigger group than species. So that whole system, so don't get thrown off by these words. So this is a pretty big group. They have soft bodies. Most have a hard calcareous shell, which means that their shells are made of calcium. We learned a little bit about that in biogeochemical cycles. When lots and lots of these critters die and sink to the bottom of the ocean, they can make a type of rock made of calcium called limestone. And they actually have brains. With the exception of clams. Clams, I think, are also in the category of sort of jellyfish and sea anemones and coral and hydra. They have obviously reflexes and things like that, but I don't believe there's a central brain to a bivalve or a clam. Whereas these other two groups, gastropods, which are snails and slugs, as well as cephalopods, which are octopus and squid, have brains. And so if we're looking at this snail, yes, it's might seem kind of dumb and simple, but it can react to stimuli, and actually all of its sort of sensation of touch and movement is all coordinated by a central feature in its head, and we call that a brain. So That's essentially what's going on there. And octopi and squids are actually really pretty intelligent. They're the most intelligent invertebrate, and they're actually more intelligent than a lot of vertebrates are. Octopi intelligence is somewhere on the level of some people put it as high as like monkey level intelligence, which is pretty high on the scale. There is a pretty great show on Netflix all about octopi and octopus called My Octopus Teacher. And it kind of goes into how intelligent octopus are. So if you're interested, go check that out. So that covers mollusks. And before we move on to this, arthropods, there are a few things that are missing in, if we're talking about the variety of life, there's actually many, many more types of invertebrates. Invertebrates are incredibly diverse, and I kind of just covered the main ones, but some other kind of big categories are worms. Worms would also kind of fall in this mollusky category in terms of, yes, some of them have brain, some of them don't kind of situation. And there's also varieties of different kinds of worms. So there's round worms, flat worms, segmented worms, all this stuff. So I didn't really want to get into it. There's also a group called echinoderms, which are starfish. And again, when you start studying all these different invertebrate groups, there things called tunicates, which are sea squirts, and all kinds of different invertebrate categories. And so I just kind of cover the main ones here. And the last main category here that I would say for invertebrates, and one of the more dominant life forms on Earth when we consider animals, I would say of all the animal species on Earth, this might take the cake. What we would call the superphylum Arthropoda. These are all things that are kind of creepy crawly on the ground and have hard exterior exoskeletons. So instead of having an internal backbone, they have an external kind of shell to them. And these are your insects, arachnids, which are spiders, crustaceans, which are things like shrimps and crabs, and chelopods, which are things like centipedes and millipedes. And those, for the most part, make up all the different kinds of arthropods. And they are each defined by a number of characteristics, but the easiest way to kind of tell them apart is how many legs they have. Insects have 6 legs. Spiders and arachnids have 8 legs. That also includes scorpions. Crustaceans have 10 legs generally, some with pinchers, which would give them 12 legs if you count their pinchers. And typically live in the water, so they have gills, but not all of them. And then chelopods are things that have lots and lots of legs. Your centipedes have a decent number of legs. That's a centipede on the right that you can see here, the bottom right. And millipedes have like thousands of legs. They're like really, really tiny. So those are your main arthropod categories. And like I said, these are incredibly abundant. Just one family of insects, the beetle family of insects, has something like 100,000 different species. So there are 100,000 types of beetles alone in the world. And so insects are incredibly abundant in the world. And the rest of these are too. Right, and then that brings us to vertebrates. All of our different kinds of vertebrates, and again, kind of working our way up through complexity here. We'll start with kind of the simplest vertebrates and kind of work our way up and talk about the different features that make them more and more complex as we move up this chain, as we get more and more complex, and we'll end with mammals. Our simplest kind of vertebrate is something called agnatha, which is a jawless fish. It's this guy right here. These kind of just latch onto other fish and kind of suck on them and eat and chew on them. This is called a lamprey. You might have heard of those. Kind of eel-like creature, but no jaws. So it's just kind of like the suction mouth. Other fishes that you might think are kind of have a suctiony mouth, technically, yes, they have a suction mouth, but the jaw features of that suction are still present. So like if you've ever had an aquarium and you have a little fish that's like a suckerfish on the side of it, Technically, that fish still has jaws. It's just a sucking jaw. This agnatha does not have any kind of jaw structure to its mouth. Which brings us to chondrichthyes, which are sharks, basically, and stingrays. These have jaws, but do not have bones yet, so they're also cartilaginous, and that's another feature of agnatha. So lampreys and whatnot do not have true bones. They're cartilaginous. Same with sharks. So a shark skeleton is not going to be as hard or durable as your skeleton. Cartilage can get pretty hard, but not nearly as hard as bone, which is kind of shocking to think about, that sharks, these massive, huge creatures, are actually kind of soft-boned. Our next class, which is a huge group of organisms, is called teleost. These are bony fishes. And pretty much anybody who's ever gone fishing before has caught all these, or anybody who's ever had an aquarium. These are, the vast majority of fishes are, fall into this category of bony fishes. And then the really strange fish, one of the strangest fishes on Earth, and they're pretty rare, is actually something called dipnoid or lungfish. These fish have gills, so they can swim around in the water like the rest of these, and they can, all fish that have gills basically can breathe oxygen through the water. So gills are designed to pull oxygen out of the water rather than the air. Because the environment this fish lives in can often dry up, this fish also has lungs, so it can survive outside of the water for an extended period of time, relying on this kind of primitive air sac feature that allows this fish to actually gulp air and survive that way. So this is a lungfish. And just so happens that the next sort of big group of vertebrates here, these are all vertebrates, so every single one of these, even if they don't technically have bones, even if they're made of cartilage, they still have an internal hard structure that's at least made of cartilage. So all of these things have backbones. So these are all vertebrates. And amphibians are kind of our next step. So if we stopped with a fish that has gills and lungs, now we move on to a organism, amphibians, that have gills at birth. So they are born as tadpoles typically and have gills. If you've ever looked at a tadpole up close, at one point they have gills. And eventually they kind of undergo a transformation in their lives where they lose their gills and they gain lungs, and that allows them to leave the water. However, their skin is still very sensitive to dryness, and so they need to be close to the water, or at least in a really wet environment, for them to survive. So typically you see frogs around ponds and things like that, and you don't see frogs in the middle of the desert. And they still rely on water to reproduce because all of their babies have gills. They need to lay their eggs in the water. So amphibians are kind of limited to aquatic environments. Reptiles, our next big group of vertebrates, are things like snakes and lizards and turtles and crocodiles. I think we're familiar with reptiles. These are things that have lungs only, so at no point in their life cycle do they have fully functional gills. And they also possess scales, and also their eggs are harder in shell, which protects them from dryness. So both scales protect their skin from dryness, and then these hard eggs, actually kind of leathery egg shells, protect the eggs from dryness. So reptiles are kind of like amphibians that have completely left the water. And for that reason, we can find reptiles in pretty much every ecosystem and habitat on Earth. Birds are actually closest related to reptiles. If you look at feathers, they're actually modified scales. And the earliest birds were essentially dinosaurs. They were modified dinosaurs, and a lot of later dinosaurs actually had feather features on them. It's kind of something that we're learning more and more as we kind of discover more and more fossils. Like a lot of the dinosaurs, even like, you know, Velociraptor in Jurassic Park and stuff, might have actually had feathers. So it's kind of a interesting idea that birds are essentially modified dinosaurs and reptiles, but that's what's going on. We would also say that birds are warm-blooded. Every other organism that we've come across so far, for the most part, is what we would consider cold-blooded. A reptile on a cold day basically just takes on the temperature of the environment. So an alligator, you know, it was like really cold last week. You know, an alligator, if it's near freezing, is basically its body is going to be near freezing and it's going to be pretty much unable to move. And that's why if you ever go outside and walk around on a really cold day, you're not going to see a bunch of lizards and snakes all crawling around because they are pretty much frozen at that point. Yeah. So for this reason, those don't survive well in super cold environments. You don't see a lot of frogs and snakes in Alaska, but you do see a lot of birds and mammals because they are warm-blooded. They regulate their own body temperature. And so even if it's really cold outside, a bird or a mammal's internal body temperature will be between 90 and 100 degrees, kind of like ours. And that brings us to mammals. Mammals are we'll kind of talk a little bit about this when we talk about evolution in our next lecture, but reptile groups kind of branched off. One group kind of made lizards and snakes and crocodiles and dinosaurs and birds, and the other branch eventually resulted in mammals. So hair is also a modified scale, believe it or not. There are certain features that are similar, especially at the cellular level, and scales and feathers and hair is all made of the same substance called keratin. I believe that's true. And so that's another evidence that these are all related. And mammals are also warm-blooded and they produce milk. All right, so that covers the variety of life on Earth. And you can see there's all kinds of different creatures on Earth and ways to kind of classify them. So that brings us to our final point here, which is just to kind of summarize a few other key concepts on biodiversity. Biodiversity, again, that just means the variety of organisms in an area or on Earth. And we just learned that there's tons and tons of variety of organisms on Earth. We have many types of microbes and plants and animals. It's unbelievable how complex the Earth is. But when we're talking about an ecosystem, like a habitat or a biome, we can actually break this down into a couple different ideas. We can talk about richness of species, or that is just how many different types of stuff are living in a particular area. So how many different types of mammals, how many different types of plants, et cetera, that would be species richness. Species evenness refers to kind of how balanced everything is in the environment. So if you have an environment where we learned about that Asian carp fish that is taking over our river systems a while back when we talked about invasive species, the Asian carp is just completely taking over, and soon most of our rivers won't have any of the native species like catfish and bass and bluegill, those things that we like to eat and fish and things like that. It's just all going to be carp. So that would be an example of how the ecosystem is kind of out of balance. So a river that only has carp, like an invasive species, that would have very low species evenness. Another river that is healthy, has lots of variety of things and everything's in balance, that would have high species evenness. All right. Some other like really important ideas when we're talking about biodiversity. Obviously we have these ecosystems with all kinds of complex things living in them. One particular ecosystem is called a kelp forest. These are common in certain coastal, kind of colder coastal environments. They have this seaweed that is called kelp. So this is a very primitive plant that's living in the ocean, and they grow very, very long in the water. And there is another kind of echinoderm. This is a kind of related to a starfish. It's called a sea urchin. And these sea urchins will eat the kelp and will actually eat the base of the kelp and kind of kill the entire thing. And if there's too many sea urchins around, all the kelp dies. And when all the kelp dies, all kinds of other creatures die off as well. All the stuff that lives in the kelp and eats the kelp will die as well. We have otters that typically live in this ecosystem, and they eat a lot of these sea urchins. And by eating the sea urchins, they prevent the sea urchin from killing the kelp, and they basically protect the entire ecosystem. So we consider them to be a keystone species. That means that they're really, really important. If they're removed, basically the entire ecosystem can collapse. So it just kind of goes to show you how complex the environment is, how we have these different interactions from different groups of organisms, seaweeds and echinoderms and mammals. And as you kind of mess with them, the entire thing can collapse very easily, especially if they rely on these keystone species. One way that otters, you know, are threatened that I know of that's just kind of bizarre, and these are kind of the things that we have to think about as humans. There is a disease carried by cats and rats called Toxoplasma gondii. It's called toxoplasmosis. It's why pregnant women shouldn't typically deal with like litter boxes and stuff, because a lot of times cats carry these parasites. Most cats do. If you're a healthy human, the parasites don't really bother you very much, but people with compromised immune systems can sometimes be harmed, and other mammals can sometimes be harmed by them. So if you have millions upon millions of cats now living in the United States, and you have millions upon millions of rats now living in the United States, none of which used to be there. You know, 1,000 years ago, there would be none of that stuff. And so you have sea otters that live in coastal areas where all of this basically rat poop and cat poop is constantly washing down bayous into the ocean. And all of these parasites are actually washing into the ocean as well. And these parasites will get into the otters and kill them. So that just kind of goes to show you that our interactions, you think, you know, having a cat is harmless, but actually, you know, can be harmful to the environment. And we have all these kinds of interactions going on in the world today. And of course, if the otter dies and the otter can't eat the sea urchin, then the entire ecosystem collapses. And I think about 50% of the kelp forests on Earth are already gone. I think I saw that stat the other day. All right, and that kind of brings us to why do we care about biodiversity in general? All these different creatures on Earth, maybe you found that interesting, maybe you found it boring that we have all this variety of life, but essentially every ecosystem on Earth can be damaged, and that's kind of natural. We have things like droughts and volcanoes, forest fires, whatever, all those things are natural. There are also unnatural aspects of disturbance, which is damage, things like invasive species introduced by humans, pollution, global warming, all these things are unnatural disturbances. But generally speaking, the more diverse an ecosystem is, the more stable it will be in the long run. So if you have a bigger variety of organisms in an environment, they will be able to kind of bounce back after a damage has been done to them. And we call the bounce back idea resilience. So how fast an ecosystem can kind of get back to where it was after, you know, there was a fire or there was some toxic pollution or an invasive species, et cetera, et cetera. And then there's resistance, which is kind of how resistant an ecosystem is to change in the first place. And what we're seeing is that as we damage the Earth more and more over time, and as we are killing off more and more species, the resilience and resistance of these ecosystems is decreasing, which means that future disturbances are going to damage them even more. And it's kind of this, like, you know, cycle of death, really, that's going on for a lot of the Earth. And of course, you know, throughout all this, I've kind of pointed out that we depend on so many of these organisms for food, medicine, technology, et cetera. And I tried to point that out as we were going through, like how many things are important. We use fungus for all kinds of food. We use bacteria for all kinds of food and medicine and all kinds of stuff. Plants the same way. Obviously, all of our food depends on plants. And most of those plants depend on bees for pollination because they're angiosperms, flowering plants. And so as we're losing more and more of this stuff, it really does pose a threat for humans as well. What am I talking about when I talk about disturbance and lowering biodiversity on Earth over time? Basically, the biggest threat to biodiversity is habitat destruction. So, for example, if you have a lot of plants and animals living in a forest and humans come and cut it down, pretty much all those plants and animals are going to die. That's pretty clear-cut understanding of biodiversity. But of course, there are some other threats, things like climate change, overfishing, pollution, all of these other things are also a threat to biodiversity. And just to kind of give you an idea, this chart sort of covers all of the known species of reptiles, fish, mollusks, flowering plants, non-flowering plants, crustaceans, other things, arachnids, insects that we know of. And this doesn't even include things like bacteria that we don't even know what all is out there with some of the stuff. These colors basically indicate what percentage of these organism groups is actually threatened right now, which means that they are at risk of going extinct and actually being removed from the world. So you can see that large portions of different life forms are currently threatened. And we know down here at the bottom, so you can see that of the species that we currently know of, a huge number are currently threatened. So at least a quarter of all species that we know of on Earth are currently threatened. And lots of species are already gone. And we probably don't even know, all the different varieties of insects because, how they're just like thousands upon thousands upon thousands of them. But we know for a fact that there's a multitude of species that are already gone extinct due to human activities. So things like 327 mollusks have already gone extinct, 136 birds have already gone extinct, 110 flowering plants, 79 mammals, 68 fish, 60 insects, 39 amphibians, 22 reptiles, 12 crustaceans, 10 non-flowering plants. So, we are already bringing on a pretty massive extinction event to Earth based off of human activities. And really this will be the focus of the entire next semester is how have humans disrupted the kind of natural processes of the Earth. And some scientists think that when humanity is all said and done, that we will result in a actual mass extinction event. For all the plants and animals on Earth, akin to what happened to the dinosaurs. So think of that meteor that hit Earth and killed off all the dinosaurs. Basically, humans will represent that in the long run. Kind of a morbid thought. And I think that is a good place to leave it.